So now for the general discussion, to explain the rules a bit. The idea is to have as few restrictions as possible, in the hope that this will not lead to chaos and cacophony, but rather to meaningful but open discussion. Whether it will work out, we'll see. In the past, it worked better than one would assume, so hopefully this will be the case today as well. So generally, any questions or comments relating to either of the lectures we've heard today, that is either Toni's or Vivek's, are welcome. If you feel the need, I mean, people can also discuss internally. So the idea is the setup is a bit, you know, classical, which suggests a certain hierarchy of opinions. Here are the people with the valid opinions, and here is the audience. This is how spatially things seem to be organized, but the general idea is to try to overcome this and encourage people to have really an open debate. Hopefully that this would lead to more interesting questions than this unilinear or one-directional, you know, Q&A sessions of a conventional type. So I'll be moderating, that is, I'll try to ensure that things do not get out of hand entirely. So that's basically it. So now we can proceed. Is anyone? Okay, good. So why don't you go first?
Okay, I'm still curious about this. Is for Vivek.
I'm still curious about this exit strategy. So when you were answering to my question, you said that people have some kind of needs. There are more than this kind of primary existential needs. But can we say that these needs, if we are not kind of essentialist, that these needs are systemically or structurally produced? So they are like, these needs are products also of capitalist system. So the question would be how people, these people who are kind of exploited workers, can see the need for systemic change if the needs that are their needs are produced by capitalist system. So are we kind of back to this vanguard idea that we need some entity that will kind of induce ideology of, for example, socialism that can offer them? Or, I mean,
I this is another hangover from both a certain reading of Marx, and there's plenty of fault that Marx himself has to share for this impression, but especially strengthened by post-war Marxism as an independent source. It's an impression that human beings are entirely constructed by their social relations and through their socialization, which simply could not possibly be true. If it were true, you would never see resistance anywhere. But one thing that we know, and one thing that we've witnessed, is this remarkable phenomenon that regardless of culture, regardless of location, regardless of time, when individuals are placed in situations which are highly coercive and highly oppressive, they resist. And what is it that they are struggling for when they resist? Two things are absolutely uniform: more physical security and more autonomy. And in my view, neither of these is socially constructed. If it were socially constructed, it wouldn't be seen everywhere. It's simply impossible for that to be the case. But the drive for self-expression and creativity has also been ubiquitous. You see it everywhere. And you see an attempt for people to find means of creativity, even in concentration camps, even in slavery. So the first question you asked, are these things a product of capitalism? The answer is no. Capitalism actually tries to systematically destroy them. They survive in spite of capitalism, not because of it. That's a separate question from how will workers see the need for systemic change? That does not come spontaneously. What workers, as I mean, as I answered in the last question that was asked about why workers often vote against their interests, what workers know is what they experience. And what they want to see different is those needs which they see being squelched. Now, what the conditions are which will allow for the flourishing of those needs, that's not something they will spontaneously know. The very idea that this is a social system is not something they spontaneously think. They just think of their own situation. The idea that the change has to be systemic and how that change comes about, that's something that, to put it crudely, comes from the outside. That's something that comes through discussion, debate, education, political organization. Now, does that have to be a vanguard? That depends on what you mean by vanguard. They do require some kind of organization. There does have to be some kind of recognition that certain workers have a class consciousness, which will be probably doing a different kind of work than others. I hesitate to use the word vanguard because all of its associations, but yeah, you're not going to spontaneously find 50 million people rising up one day. It's going to require organization. Is that vanguardism? If you think it is, then yes, then you need a vanguard. So there's two separate answers to your question. And I'll just say this. Marxists, socialists have an amazing ability to be schizophrenic. So they will constantly deny that there's such thing as human needs, human nature, etc. But if that were true, your own activities would make no sense. The only reason you can organize anybody at all is because you, when discussing with them their situation, you point to the fact that these needs are being suppressed. That's the essence of injustice. The reason capitalism is unjust is because it suppresses people's needs. If it was creating those needs, why would it be suppressing them? So the Marxists have to come to terms, socialists have to come to terms with the fact that they may deny that human beings have needs, but it's the existence of those needs that makes sense of their activities. Otherwise, their activities make no sense.
Darko, yeah, I would just want to carry on about this, about needs. I think that when we talk whether capitalism produces or suppresses the needs, I don't think it is the whether or. I think it is both, actually. Because we have to keep in mind that workers are not just workers, they are both consumers. And on that side, their needs are being produced. The needs to buy the better house, better car, and everything, which goes with that. But on the other hand, they are workers, and their needs need to be lowered down in order for wage to be lowered down. And this is the contradiction inside of capitalist system of relations, I think. So I wouldn't say that this set of needs is definitely not natural, and it depends. It goes up and down in historical development. So yeah, I think that it's not whether or. I think it's both. It is destruction and creation of the needs.
I think that's absolutely right, exactly right. I think we can say there. We can, in any given historical period, we can make a distinction between needs which are transhistorical and which are kind of part of the people's biological endowment. They're kind of born with them. They're more like instincts. And then there's needs which are entirely the product of their times. What Marxists have done and what Marx himself did wrongly was to simply focus on needs which are entirely the product of the times and then say that's all there is to human beings. But as Chomsky likes to say, if you really believe that, you shouldn't object to any social order because every social order just creates the people that it requires. If we say that a social order is unjust, it has to be by using a metric that the social order itself doesn't construct. So with the caste system in India, the caste system says to people, you are where you are because that's what you deserve. Now we say that's unjust, why? Because we say people don't deserve, and here's the beauty of it. It's not just in the 20th century that people who were untouchables or Dalits said that what's being done to us is unjust. They were saying it in the 16th century. How? Because even back then, what they experienced is something that was an affront to their own sensibilities. So there are these transhistorical needs, but as you're absolutely correctly saying, there are specific ones as well.
Tibor is next. Just a short note on essentialism. I think it's very sad and funny at the same time how over the decades, over the past few decades, the term essentialism has become a swear word, a term of derision. Especially on the left, and the post-structuralist left. It's sad because usually when you read people who deride essentialism and who accuse others of being essentialist, don't even know what essentialism means. And the second connected thing, the funny thing is that every social scientist, even the post-structuralist ones, are essentialist in the sense that if you use the term capitalism and differentiate it from feudalism, you're essentialist because you separated out certain essential features of capitalism that make it capitalism and certain essential features that make feudalism feudalism. So everybody is an essentialist.
Well, I would just like to expand on what has just been said, but it's also a question for you. I found it interesting because I think it's not something that you hear too often. On the one hand, your analysis of where the stability of social order comes from is, I don't know, some would probably say, I don't know if that's the right word, but, you know, very bleak or something like that. And on the other hand, the analysis of, I don't know, what would be the potential sources of resistance are, some would say, probably too optimistic. In terms, they are basically humanist, I would say, that the resistance wouldn't come out from, I don't know, the internal laws of capitalism, but, you know, you said, at least that's how I understood it, because it's in human nature, I don't know, for it's in human nature for people to strive for a society, I don't know, in which, you know, free development of each is condition of free development of all. And I would like to ask you, why do we don't hear more often, you know, these claims to basically Marxist humanist explanations for any kind of change?
Boy, I wish I knew the answer to that. I've come to believe that it's because academics are corrupt people who have no interest in understanding anything, but maybe I'm cynical. I honestly can't answer why we don't hear this more often, because I just think it's obviously true. And I was saying to Tibor earlier, I find it highly depressing that I have to give talks like this at all, because this is really simple stuff. Talks within the left should be over really hard questions of strategy and tactics and political orientation and all that. Not over how does capitalism, where does stability come from, is there a human nature, can brown people be rational, you know, things like that. But these are our times. And I think one big reason why, if one had to choose what the reason is that one doesn't hear this right now, it's because I think the left has just been decimated for so long. There has never been a period in the history of capitalism since the French Revolution where you went so long without some massive anti-capitalist mobilization in some major regions of the world. The last time we really saw them was 68. We're going on 50 years now. If you go back to 1789, where capitalism existed, Western Europe on down, every 20 to 30 years you saw a major crisis, political crisis. And that's been the lifeblood of the left. That's what gave the left intelligentsia its reasons for optimism, its vision of the world, what it theorized about where capitalism comes from. That's what kept the intelligentsia linked to a moral vision. Whenever you've seen these social movements recede, you've seen a cultural degeneration. Two things are new in this period. One is, it's the longest we've gone without a big social movement. And the second is, it is the first time where you can say the anti-capitalist left has actually been destroyed. And that's resulted, in my view, in a profound cultural and intellectual degeneration. And we're not out of it yet. One symptom of that degeneration is a basic contempt towards ordinary people and their humanity, their decency, and their dreams and visions. And that contempt issues in a denial of the very needs and capacities on their part, which intellectuals take for granted on their own. You give an academic instructions on what to write, when to write, how to write it, and the world is coming apart. It's the worst thing that could ever happen to them. But you can say it to workers, And the academics won't even notice. Well, they don't have any needs. That's where we are.
Okay, I have a comment. It relates to what you've mentioned in the lecture about, and basically follows up on the question of contradictions within Marx. So we've commented already on this, on the moments where it seems that Marx is basically a proponent of this revolutionary optimism, where basically the very structure of the capitalist mode of production will generate its grave diggers, you know, the working class, the formulation is with the inevitability of a natural law, I believe, you know. So this is one aspect. But the other part of that contradiction, I would argue, is that in Marx's, and this is something which has been developed in German debates, especially by Michael Heinrich and others, in the so-called Neue Marx lecture or New Reading of Marx, an emphasis on that Marx, that, well, Heinrich's argument, not only his, is that these quotes in which can be found in Capital basically are not a consequence of the systemic aspect of his analysis, but rather an addition of a form of, well, revolutionary will. And in fact, in that sense, contaminate his, already at least in contradiction to the reasoning that he gives for the stability of capitalist social relations, which do develop from development of his systemic analysis and critique of the capitalist mode of production. And this one of the central categories in that tradition, which has been emphasized, is the problematic of fetishism, but not in a way which differs from how it's usually perceived. So Heinrich even talks about the fetishism of bourgeois relations, so not only commodity fetishism, capital fetishism, but that this whole problematic, to use the Althusserian term, entails also various inversions and mystifications. And one of these, which Marx himself emphasizes as crucial, is the mystification of the wage form itself. So, of course, this is, you mentioned, and you said, I believe at one point, that the only arguments in favor of workers accepting capitalism in Marx can be found with statements on the sphere of circulation, equality, and bantam, and all that. But, of course, there is also the problematic of fetishism, which includes the mystification of the wage form itself, which basically hides exploitation, insofar as it appears as if labor is paid for, but in fact what is paid for is the capacity to labor, labor power, the value of labor power, and exploitation in this very technically strict sense of the word is basically something which does not depend on the immediate experience of the quality of the labor process. In its very strict technical sense, I can absolutely enjoy the labor process, I can be a worker who can be happy and still be exploited, I can think that the compensation I get is fair, that I get a fair wage, and still be exploited, because the definition, the Marxist definition of exploitation is precisely the labor, the value I produce, which exceeds the value of the labor power I was compensated for. So everything beyond that, regardless of how I feel about this, is of course is exploitation. And the argument is then and you said workers do struggle against in the labor process. Of course, historically this is the case, and there is the heteronomy of capital in opposition to autonomy, because there is the will of the other, the will of the system, the systemic imperatives of capitalism, which uses the labor as a tool for its own goals. And this, of course, is something you experience. But but the question is then, okay, of course, this is the capital labor antagonism is constitutive, and it is everywhere. Class struggle in that sense is everywhere. But the question is it a class struggle within capitalism for fair wages, for fair compensation? And this is then, or is it a form of class struggle which has the potential to transcend capitalism? Is it anti-capitalist? Is it directed against exploitation as such? or against perceptions of violations of certain norms. And Michael Lebowitz has recently written on this, on the notion of the concept of fairness, and he basically develops E.P. Thompson's argument about the moral economy of the working class. And, he states, historically, most organizations, most protest, most of the struggles of the working class historically have been defensive. That is, defending certain notions of fair wages, a moral economy of the working class. They were not directed as exploitation as such, because capitalism is the only form of exploitative class society where exploitation as such, in this technical sense, is not immediately visible because of the inversion inherent in the very wage form. So I would argue that this, in any discussion about a materialist foundation for a theory of ideology, unlike Althusserian, the Althusserian one, where I would, as I said, I would even radicalize maybe your criticism. What is central in his the theory of interpolation, which binds everything together. I mean, we know the notions about materiality and the everything he takes from Gramsci in terms of the expanded notion of the state, you know, the integrated state. I believe, I don't know, I don't remember now the exact translation. And, but what it stands or falls on, what is really productive theoretically, the central concept is interpolation, and this is basically a borrowing from Lacanian theory of the mirror stage. And it presupposes always successful interpolation. But the question is, for one could argue, there are always many different interpolations. When and which ones are successful, which aren't, and you need a criteria for that. Althusser already assumes that they are successful, but you know, the working class is interpolated with competing narratives, and to have a criteria for which ideological narratives will produce this effect of I recognize myself in this, you have to have a criteria of plausibility, and this can only be materialistic. And this is where I agree. So there is no materialist ideology of theory in Althusser, I would even state. But I think that the notion, the fetishism problematic, could precisely provide a conceptual link between the question of the structural effects, structural imperatives, as you have enumerated them, the need to sell, to ensure one's reproduction by selling one's labor power, and the resignation which this may entail. But I think one also has to take into account that the form of appearance of social relations in capitalism, which the inversion of the mystification of the wage form indicates, is also contributing to this type of to the perpetuation, to the stabilization of the system, because exploitation as such, in this technical sense, which is not the same as this everyday notion of exploitation, which is, oh, I feel bad, I'm treated bad, badly by my boss, that this is also, I would say, you know, maybe not the missing link, but a necessary link for any true attempt to find the adequate place of ideology and its relation to structural imperatives.
I will say yes. I mean, I prefer to call it reification than fetishism. I think fetishism has a narrower ambit inside Marxist theory. But your other point that the structure of social relations itself contributes a lot to making ideological claims plausible in capitalism is absolutely true. And you know, I imagine Tony's lecture earlier today on Clark's theory must have pointed to this, that the appeal of the marginalist economic theory to dominant groups is that it's a intuitively plausible justification for the wage form. And it is an argument that is possible to make in a way that wouldn't be possible in serfdom or slavery, which is I'm giving you your wage, and the wage you're getting reflects your contribution to the product. You know, and Clark was very open about this, that we need to move out of surplus economics towards this marginalist form because surplus economics are too ideologically explosive. So the the what's called a realm of exchange in capitalism is real, and the ideological justifications that capitalism generates point to the realm of exchange and not to what Marx called the hidden abode of production. But that means that they're real. And that's why the concept of reification, I think, can actually, as you said, be a bridge for that.
I have a banal question, but when you were talking, answering the question before, Steve is about, and you mentioned that we haven't witnessed the mass social movement like in like 50 years. Just question, why? But what's your take on that? In terms of, was it some kind of new modes of resignation? Or I'm just kidding, but it's does it tell us something about the way how the capitalist domination is reorganized? Do you think that this theory of neoliberalism in some way are adequate response to that to that process? And also the question when you also said that the complete destruction of the radical left, why it happened? Does it have the kind of connections to with the breakup of the so-called real socialism, or just take on this a kind of historical anomaly in a sense?
I don't know, Marco. I don't think we have a good answer to that on the left. I think few people on the left have even thought about this very hard right now. It's hard to imagine that it's been brought about by one cause operating on its own, because there are too many counter tendencies within capitalism that push people towards collective resistance. If I had to say, I would say the following, and this is just something for all of us to think about. There's no doubt whatsoever that there has been a reorganization of capitalism which has made collective action harder. The workplaces have become smaller, more dispersed, and therefore harder to organize. So that's point number one. Point number two is, when the great wave of organizing in capitalism took place in the early 1900s onward, there were several simultaneously operating mechanisms which functioned to not only put workers in a place where they could become organized, these large factories and horrible work conditions, but they layered over them other factors which also structurally pushed towards the creation of an identity. So what were these? Workers lived together in these ghettos. They all faced horrible working conditions. In many countries, they still didn't have the right to vote. So they were also disenfranchised, which generated a lower social status for them. They were not only exploited, they were poor. Now, as Stipe said, exploitation in Marxism simply means that you are generating a surplus. That's quite compatible with having a very good income. In the early 20th century, you were exploited and poor. So workers were impoverished, living in slums, denied basic rights, facing similar work conditions. Now, all of that makes the creation of a collective identity a lot easier. What do we have today? They're in smaller workplaces. They are living in suburbs. They don't talk to each other. They're sucked into a highly atomized lifestyle. Something like what 80% of the waking time of Americans is spent at work and shopping. How are you going to organize when that's taking place, right? So these things go into a texture of life, I think, that makes it harder to organize people. And then on top of that is not just the destruction of the left. There's a destruction of the left that occurred in countries like England and the United States. There's also been the absorption of the left into the state. So there's no force that is actively present trying to counterbalance all of these forces pulling workers apart. I think that it's something to do with the combined operation of all of these factors, every one of which is pushing in a different direction than the factors of the early 20th century.
Do you think that this kind of atomization, all this process, do you treat it as a hidden, so-called hidden agenda from the ruling classes, or like their political project, or is it some kind of effect of reorganizations of the labor processes because of some imperatives of production?
The destruction of trade unions was absolutely, of course, an agenda. It was carried out consciously, and it's being carried out consciously right now in the EU. In the US and England, it was carried out consciously, and the EU right now is more or less committed to the, first the domestication of labor, and ultimately, of course, it's organizational pulling apart. But the structural changes we're talking about in the way in which work is being carried out, the way in which living styles are different, the suburbanization of the working class, those are unintended consequences of the shifts in the patterns of accumulation in capitalism. What the left has not yet been able to do is find an organizational response to these structural shifts. And we are in the first steps of a renewal of the left to try to find organizational forms that will be appropriate to the realities of capitalism today. We're largely failing, but that's okay. You'll fail, and then ultimately you'll succeed.
Okay, we have Toni, Darko, Alan, and then Jeff in that order. So, Toni?
Just briefly to address what you said, about Clark, their main goal of neoclassicals was, well, explicitly with Clark, more clear than anybody else, to remove the notion of expectation. Yeah. There is no surplus. If there's no surplus, if every factor of production is paid justly and rightly according to its marginal contribution at the margin of the physical product, then we'll send you money backwards according to your contribution, so you're fairly. That was their goal, that was their plan, and it was really important to cleanse it out of economic classrooms, textbooks. Well, textbooks didn't exist at the time, but from the theoretical field, and they understood the importance of it. So I'm glad that your presentation was so focused on exploitation, because also this morning this is how it was cleansed, and now why it's not there. Well, I mean, that was economic field was only one place, of course, it's not determining one. But to answer Marco's question and to bring back to your social movements, there were social movements. I mean, I've lived in London last two decades. They were different. They addressed, you had late 90s, you had the anti-globalization movement, and early 2000s, which primarily addressed, I mean, it became known in the Western world and in mainstream media from Seattle onwards, but that was only the pinnacle of the top of the iceberg, so to say, the anti-NAFTA movement, the Chiapas, and so, but it was addressed at the needs of the people who subjectively felt exploited in the rest of the world, not in the Western countries. So when you had protest in London, when you had 50,000 people on the streets of London, you had them protesting on behalf of people who felt subjectively exploited somewhere in the so-called third world, even though technically, you know, every Londoner is as exploited as someone in southern hemisphere. So, and then riots recently, 2011, when in Tottenham they crushed the shops and they stole, you know, PlayStations and you know, trainers that cost £100. Kids from the local estates, places where I live mostly for most of the time. I'd say that the technical notion of exploitation, it just doesn't stick with anyone in England, for example, and that it doesn't stick because the flow of material wealth that goes your way, you know, crashes any possible notion of am I being fulfilled by my arts, or, you know, can I educate myself better? Do I have more time with my kids or my friends? Or so the change that even England, I mean, it's easy to, when you live in London, it's easy to forget, but the change that England went from the quality of life from after Second World War, you know, around that era, simply material quality of life, to what people experience nowadays. When I talk to locals, I mean, who can compare their experience with their grandparents, they say, well, yeah, we're quite oppressed, we understand, you know, we work long hours, but it's worth it. You know, there's a trade-off, is stress, there is this sense that you said a few times in your presentation that, you know, you believe, I think it has to be leftist axiom, that you have to believe in other people's capability to understand their position. I fully agree. But given that, we have to also understand that the notion of exploitation, no matter how it may be removed from academic Marxism, it's not removed when you talk to people. I mean, talking to ordinary Londoners, they perfectly understand they're being exploited. Even in technical terms, not in Marxist sense, but they understand our labor creates this, then someone takes a chunk, gives us a chunk in advance. But they're saying, but what's the alternative? That's your exit strategy. Then they tell me, what's the alternative? And, well, but once a month we fly anywhere in the world where we want. You know, that's a middle class aspect. So I think it's not that technically you can't explain, it's that the life experience, there are no exit strategies, and life experience says my grandmother lived so poorly that actually this exploitative situation I'm in is okay.
Darko?
Yeah. Tony also that we have resistance even after the 69, but 68, but it hasn't been the anti-capitalist in this sense. And why it hasn't been? I think that I agree with that there is a lot of factors influencing it. It is hard to single out the one the main factor. But after saying this, I think that. This change in living in suburbs, automation, deindustrialization, smaller working fields and everything only explains maybe a partial situation in Western Hemisphere. For the global South, it isn't necessarily this kind of situation. You still have slums. You still have places of residence that should create this kind of culture, but you don't have this. And I think that if I understood you correctly, your lecture, this idea that ideology is more important for the building of resistance. I think this is the main issue, the main factor in lacking the organized anti-capitalist resistance is that demise of the socialist projects, especially in the USSR, brought down this idea of the socialism as and Marxist theory with it as some viable option for building the better society. So I think that this is the thing that we are first trying to rebuild this as viable utopia, so to say, and from that only to organize the resistance that would be anti-capitalist and not outer globalist or something like this. Yeah.
Can I just say one thing? There's never a time in capitalism where there isn't resistance. So of course it's true that one can point to riots and mobilizations, you know, but we should be clear about something. By historical standards, these have been puny. Don't kid yourselves. And it's really important for people on the left to be real, not to delude themselves, not to throw fantasies around. There has been an uptick of resistance in the past, say, 10 years. It should have started with Seattle, but then because of 9/11, for about 6 years, it'd been back underground. And then it came up again starting in 2008, 2009. And it's significant, I think. And I think these kinds of meetings right now that are occurring, they're larger, bigger, more well attended. The phenomenon of Corbyn and Brexit in England, Sanders in the United States, these are all signs that the long malaise might be over. But don't kid yourselves. What Seattle and the anti-war mobilizations and Occupy, all of these, by historical standards, they're tiny, they're blips. There have not just been anti-capitalist mobilizations since 1789, every 20, 30 years. You actually had revolutions, 1830, 1848. Then the longest period you had gone until now was between 1848 and the 1890s, without anything. Then starting in 1905, an era of revolution that stretches all the way into the 1940s. Then 68, and then quiescence. So there's signs, there's things to be happy with, but there's never been a time when the working class was as quiescent for so long a period, and we've never gone so long without genuine massive breakdowns and upheavals. That's point number one. Point number two, what you say about the global South is really true. What I said about the conditions changing was much more about Europe and the advanced world than about the global South. I don't want to take up too much time. The obstacles in the global South are of a slightly different character, and maybe when the discussion goes in that direction, we can talk about it. But whatever they are, globally, there has never been a period this long, this quiescent in the modern era. And that's why we are the ideological, cultural, intellectual malaise and degeneration and corruption, I think, that one finds oneself in.
Ale? I have a comment, and of hope you could comment back. I'm of the impression that you said a lot about what ideology isn't, and in this regard I agree. For example, when you said that when workers are told that the free market is the best way to make things work, etc., they accept this because they're not experts in economics in order to be able to tell that it's not true, right? And that this isn't false consciousness. And I completely agree. I think the concept of false consciousness is one of the most counterproductive concepts in Marxism. But then, what would you say that ideology is? So where would you locate ideology? For me, the most convincing, one of the at least most convincing arguments is that how basically Gramsci defines hegemony as intellectual and moral leadership. So basically, the subaltern classes, in Gramsci's terms, are being led to believe certain things, right? So the example you gave about the free market might be one such example, right? And he explicitly says, like, if you imagine a situation where you would discuss with the worker about something as complex as economics, they would tell you that basically they can't explain themselves why the free market is good or beneficial, but that someone more competent than them would be able to do so, right? This is the reason why I mentioned that in a sense you can view the state as the materiality of ideology, because in a specific reading of Gramsci, which is done by Jan Rehman and Wolfgang Fritz Haug, it is the institutions of the state which, if nothing else, at least participate in the dissemination of this knowledge, which is basically ideological knowledge, ideology, right? And this is something which Toni talked about, right? This is most present in economics, precisely because economics deals with the spheres of production, exchange, etc., etc. So, if you could comment on that.
Gramsci does say that. So, first, your question is to me: what is ideology? And there are two traditions in Marxist theory about how to conceptualize ideology. One tradition says ideology is simply the symbolic universe through which you attain your subjectivity. So ideology is the means by which you attain your subjectivity, your political consciousness, your individual subjectivity. That is what you might call a neutral conception of ideology. So the ideology is simply the prism through which you see the world. A second tradition defines ideology as a more limited subset of people's subjectivities. Ideology is those components of your subjectivity which obscure the true nature of reality. So ideology now has a distinctively negative connotation. Ideology is all those things which are encapsulated in a misapprehension about the world. My view is, that's how I think of ideology. I think of subjectivity as different from ideology. There's people's subjectivity. And then, so I use ideology as a verb, something being ideological. So I would define ideology as simply all those parts of your consciousness which obscure the true nature of social reality. That's my view. Okay, that's separate from the other things which you said, which is what are the means by which ideology secures its location? And for Gramsci, you correctly, I think, said that ideology or hegemony amounts to ideological leadership. But now here's the key. This is where, in the post-Althusserian milieu, and a lot of the Gramscian scholars are guilty of this, there's been a misapprehension about what enables a class to secure its leadership and its ideological leadership. It is not done through propaganda or through organs of the media or through the state. Gramsci is very clear on this. The leadership of a class stems from the economic role that it plays, from the fact that it actually is able to further the development of the productive forces. And in furthering the development of the productive forces, it secures its leadership by the successful coordination of its interests with the interests of the subordinated classes. That coordination comes about because the subordinated classes actually experience an improvement in the conditions of their existence by virtue of the leadership being exercised by the dominant class. Gramsci is a very, very, very committed follower of Marx's preface to the 1859 contribution to critique of political economy. Every time Gramsci brings up the issue of leadership, he says, one must remember or one must take as axiomatic Marx's preface. So Gramsci, far from being the theorist of the autonomization of culture, is the most rock-ribbed economic determinist you can ever imagine. And it's a colossal achievement of the post-war left that they've managed to obscure this. Gramsci's a very ordinary Leninist. All he thinks he's doing is fleshing out the cultural consequences of this economic fact. So when a class is actually able to secure the development of the productive forces, it then layers over the successful economic leadership that it exercises with all these cultural, symbolic, propagandistic, media-based ideological mechanisms. All that stuff going on in ideology for Gramsci has no place unless the class that's in rule actually is advancing the productive forces. And what that means is culture doesn't give you anything as a mechanism of hegemony when the mode of production is in decay. Does this sound familiar? That is Marx's preface. Okay. So that being the case then, the last question you had building on that was what now? Just remind me.
If the state could be...
No, obviously not.
Yeah.
I mean, look, it's just one organ. How could it... True, Gramsci says the state is the apex of this system, but all he's saying is any class that's successfully leading and securing its rule is ultimately going to have to use the power of the state to secure its ideological hegemony. Well, that's obviously true. But that doesn't mean that it's only the state. It simply means that the state is the ultimate apex of all of these institutions of the class. If you look at the prison notebooks in their full form, Gramsci has page after page after page in his studies that he's laid out for himself where he's going to examine this newspaper, that magazine, this aspect of cultural production, this university. He's looking at every single institution. So that means he thinks it's a manifold set of mechanisms that secure hegemony. The state is simply the apex of it. And I think that's obvious. Why confine yourself to the state?
Jeff?
I guess I want to just start by saying this is an awesome event. I'm really happy to be here, and I've never been to a Marxist event in Zagreb before, and I'm so happy to see there's so many Marxists in Zagreb. There's not that many where
I live.
Well, that's okay. I guess I just want to kind of continue the conversation that Tony sort of invited. I missed your talk this morning, but I like everything you said so far. I'm sorry I missed your talk. Which is that, you know, this idea of kind of resignation I find very compelling. It's deceptively simple. I think that you're onto something really cool. But I'm still kind of trying to figure out how to think about resignation as a replacement for ideology, which is to say as a kind of description of what makes the actions of workers deliberate and calculated and rational, which I believe was the word that you preferred in your talk, over whatever, like spontaneous and accidental or dupish. So I buy that. And I think that's a very politically motivating way to change the conversation. I totally get that. But then, as you know very well, being from the New York context, the identity politics is alive and well right now. Right? It's kind of like the context out of which a lot of conversations about sort of like the left and the progressive movement are anchored right now, frustratingly. Though, there's also, I think, a lot, and this gets back to your comment about the riots and the kind of rise of a sort of alternative, or let's say older, but nevertheless like recurrent form of political collective action that maybe doesn't resonate with the workers' model. I'm wondering if there's a way we can use the concept of resignation, but outside of the factory, or outside of the kind of production, the site of production. And if there's a way we can think about resignation as a kind of socialized or inhabited position, right? To sort of like re-ideologize it, but towards the ends that you're asking for us to think about ideology, which is as a kind of motivation or mobilization, rather than a sort of like further resignation in the negative sense. So, in other words, do you have to be a worker and get a wage in any traditional or even non-traditional sense to be deliberate? about your about the kinds of exploitations and dominations that you will accept and the kinds that you won't. And if not, is resignation maybe an opportunity, like thinking about identity politics in the US today, an opportunity to think about the ways in which those political, let's say, embers can be made resonant again with a kind of workerist project, a Marxist or a socialist project. Is there a way, or I'll put it in the positive, or I'll ask the question directly, how do we recuperate the political energy of identity politics as we would probably understand it in this room, which is a kind of like, you know, almost coherent attempt to represent the means of social exclusion via non-economic categories back into the fold of a kind of like socialist project? And if I hope that the answer is yes, but I want to know how, because it's something I really struggle with, and it's something my comrades in the United States and Canada struggle with too. And I feel like it's a pressing question right now. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think that if the labor movement gets going again in the United States, it will absolutely and by necessity be a labor movement that includes within it a battle against social oppressions. So the what's called identity politics can be thought of in two ways. Identity politics of the last 20 to 25 years is basically, it's a form of middle class politics. It's looking at people's forms of social exclusion, but net of their imbrication in economic injustice, net of that. It's just, so it looks at the ways in which their formal rights are left incomplete, on symbolic aspects of the way in which they're absorbed into the culture, on the promises of upward mobility not being fulfilled because of various forms of discrimination. What it leaves out is the various ways in which the social exclusion and the domination of people around their identities is immediately caused by their lack of economic resources and their vulnerability in the labor market, and their subjection to the kinds of labor extraction that the labor movement focuses on. So it's become a quite conservative movement, in my opinion. That it's a movement really about people in universities and in professional situations wanting to know why they can't have everything that white men, heterosexual white men, have. That does not mean that identity politics is in some way inimical to the emergence of a socialist movement again. Precisely because the socialist movement, if it gets going again, of the working class, is going to have to solve these problems if it's ever going to create a solidaristic community within itself. Since workers are now include a huge percentage of women, and Latinos and blacks will actually be a majority of the labor force potentially by 2040, there's no labor movement without taking up questions of race and gender. It's not going to happen. But the way in which they take up questions of race and gender will be fundamentally different from the way they're taken up today. The way in which they're taken up will include, as part of their agenda, economic justice, healthcare, jobs, etc., not the way Hillary Clinton conceptualized it as intersectionality or this, that, or the other. So in my view, there is no real opposition between identity politics, if you conceptualize identity politics as anti-oppression politics, and class politics. Class politics is also anti-oppression politics. That is not just class oppression, but gender and race oppression as well. What's happened because of the destruction of the labor movement is that the middle class took over identity politics. That's going to have to change. Bernie Sanders' campaign is the first step in the US towards giving a class content to anti-oppression politics. But as we saw the reaction to it on the part of the liberal intelligentsia, a big chunk of the Marxist intelligentsia, the road to recapturing a progressive and socialist component to identity politics is going to be a long and arduous one, because it's been taken over by upwardly mobile professionals, black, women, and LGBT.
Well, a question for Toni, and maybe Vivek can also comment. maybe this has been already mentioned in the morning lecture, maybe it's too banal or too basic, but what would be the neoclassical rationale for this idea of the market functioning as a kind of a democratic mechanism whereby we vote for choices by using our money in the market to buy commodities? So can you comment a little bit about that, and maybe Vivek can comment how this, let's say, consumerist interpolation fits into his theory of ideology?
Well, I mean, for neoclassicals, that's an important, it was an important breakthrough, especially with Buchanan and public choice theory and Milton Friedman's work as well. But what they succeeded in their own minds, and it has not been accepted throughout neoclassical field. Like I said, these are many schools that compete, and one ends up in textbooks, and often textbook is a mixture of, and what's taught at university is a mixture of neoclassical ideas of various strands. So not everyone would buy into that today in neoclassical community, and there was also left neoclassical. You wouldn't believe it, we haven't discussed it, but there was a strand of left neoclassicalism as well, no matter how strange it may sound. But they managed to connect back the idea of democracy to this economic determinism on a micro level. So it was again, an individual can participate in, you know, how society is run through a wallet, as they say, simple, you know, vote via wallet. I don't think it was quite a successful theory. I mean, from what I've read, it's large sections of neoclassical and mainstream economists, they were not convinced about this theory, even though, you know, it's omnipresent as a folk saying today, vote for your feet and vote for your wallet. By elsewhere, but it goes well, really nicely, with the move from production to from physicalist production. So production is only physicalist. We can't aggregate commodities or inputs. To we will introduce money only when the goods are sold. So it goes really, really nice with that story, because it only adds an additional element there, which is democratic element of. We haven't discussed it this morning, but it's. The issue of lack of any sort of democratic notion within mainstream economics is, it has been a problem for them. They try to address it that way. I think that's their weak spot, and I don't think still they have any good, meaningful answer. And they don't agree on answers, which is good, because then you can pick up a fight.
I mean, they do have an answer, and it's a very powerful one, I think. If all neoclassical economics has to say is that you vote with your wallet, then it has a problem, because people's wallets are unequal. And by definition, it means that some people are going to have more votes than the others. So the answer that they have to this is a powerful and simple one, which is that what people have in their wallet reflects their choices. Now, you might say, what does that mean? There's capitalists, and they're really rich, and there's workers who are really poor. The answer, which Paul Samuelson elucidated some time back, was that there is no obstacle to anybody becoming a capitalist. And there is no obstacle to anybody who wants to be a capitalist hiring out as many people as they want. With perfectly functioning credit markets, anybody who has an idea for an entrepreneurial initiative goes to the bank, and since the banks are rational and they see that this entrepreneurial idea is going to generate profits, they will give the loan to anybody who wants to be a capitalist. So, in effect, the people who are workers today are workers because they would rather be workers than to be capitalists. Because if they wanted to be entrepreneurs, they would go and get the loans that they needed. So Samuelson famously said, in capitalism, it's just as plausible to say that workers hire capitalists as it is to say that capitalists hire workers. Since there are no obstacles to anybody shifting class positions, what inequality does exist on these assumptions is going to be an inequality reflective of people's choices, not of the constraints that they function in. Which means then that if people vote with their wallets and some wallets are thinner than others, that's a choice that they made. And the inequality in voting power reflects the personal preferences of the individuals. So if you buy the theory, it's an irrefutable answer to the Marxist objections to capitalism. Since the premise of Marxism is that the means of production are monopolized by one group of people, and the people who work for them don't have any access to the means of production except through and as employees of the people who monopolize the means of production, right? So that's one answer to your question. And as Toni is saying, there's disagreements around this, but the essence of the neoclassical response to Marxism has been that. And this is where the power of people like John Romer's objections, what Romer tried to show was that on neoclassical assumptions, on the assumption of perfectly functioning markets, you can show that in fact workers cannot hire capitalists. Anyway, so that's a debate that's gone on. Your answer, the question to me, Martin, about how would people's interpolation as consumers feed into my analysis of social stability is it doesn't. I think it's a minor phenomenon, this idea that people are interpolated as consumers and that's what hooks them into the system, since the American working class, the bulk of it, doesn't have disposable income. It's swimming in debt. This interpolation as consumers happens to people at higher up in the income ladder. Now, even workers, it is true, will go and shop whenever they can. It's a very minor part of why they, as it were, accept their lot or don't organize. This is one of the negative legacies of Marcuse, one-dimensional man and all this business, which is that you look for the answers to stability in people's consciousness rather than in their objective situation.
Just to come back, it's good to have disagreements sometimes, but I disagree with your reading. I think that the idea of democracy is a lot stronger, and maybe if we go strictly by Marxist argument, especially by more strict reading in his Critique of Political Economy, how I understand Marx's work, yes, then possibly voting with your wallet is a good enough answer. Anyone can become a capitalist. Like, it's a matter of your choice, especially with the way they theorize.
No, not in Marx. I'm saying this is a neoclassical.
Yeah, no, I know. Their answer to Marxism, yes, can be correct in that sense. But the problem is lack of democratic theory in Marxism itself. It's not a problem, but how neoclassical reacts. They react to it precisely because the left has no democratic theory of its own that's, in my view, strong enough or good enough to carry the project of emancipation forward. So that's why their answer can be so pathetic. Because in the first instance, the left position on this is pathetic and historically inadequate. So what I mean by that, I mean that democracy at workplace is never theorized. In a sense of Marxian framework that we have given as our foundation of our thought, we don't have a way to just bolt onto Marxian chunk of this, chunk of that, and we'll combine, democracy of workplace. I mean, we here have we're in a position to study whatever Yugoslavia had as a matter of, archives are still there, whatever is left of them. But this is an argument Haju Chang often makes it, and he's very, I don't know how loud is he's in US, he's very loud in the UK, very omnipresent, a lot of students, which is great, that voting with your wallet is unequal. So no matter what answer neoclassicals will give, this inequality is really, it goes to the root of the, not just left, but kind of people's movements, not just labor movements for, one vote, one man. I mean, otherwise, if we accept the neoclassical answer, then we are back to, I've got 10 units of some currency, so I have 10 votes, you have one vote. That is the landowners in England before the vote was introduced first for men and then for everyone. So I think that the way left perceives its own questions at what democracy should be about and how it gives its own answers, that shapes what the neoclassicals and, what the liberal answers can be. And because our questions are quite, I think, insufficient, therefore we get these simple answers which just walk all over us. And I think here I would go back to your needs, which I completely agree that's lacking in the left. Michael Lebowitz writes a lot about it in different ways, but beyond Capital, his work is a foundation of the idea, which is that, without self-development, without, human development, which is not just going to be economic development, but socio-economic human development, without left having a notion of human development, which will carry through as a systemic field, things you were talking about in your lecture and earlier, without that, the place of work and wage labor, no matter how administered or how this cake is sliced at the end, it's a shitty cake, basically. So I think we have a Marxism and the left has, we have a insufficiently good set of questions, therefore the enemy can walk all over us. But their question, their answer is not good enough, because as Haji Chang would say, well, it's landed democracy again. So you have 10, I have 1, I have 10 votes. So, but I agree with you. I mean, they succeeded in a kind of folk way of, you know, common sense. They succeeded in convincing people this is the case. So I think they're in that ideological sense that we talked about. And I would say that the state and the media do play a role, because, like you said, you know, it's a limited information we get. Whatever we get frames our daily, you know, it's like me and what do I know about chemistry? But if something comes from it, from mainstream me, that's what I think about chemistry. What do I know? So in the same way, it's about economics and politics and emancipation. But I still think it's, you know, we need to deal with our own questions and our own problems, then they won't be able to give such easy answers.
It would be Stefan now, but I would maybe argue that to honor our first explicit disagreement of the evening, if Vivek wants to respond to...
I might have misunderstood the question. I was simply responding to what I thought Martin was asking, which is, does neoclassical economics have an answer to the issue that if you're voting with your wallet, it's an unequal vote? I didn't disagree with anything that Toni said in response, because maybe we misunderstood each other. What I was saying was that neoclassical, because initially I thought Toni said they don't have much of an answer. And I said, well, they do have an answer, which is the inequalities in your wallet reflect autonomous choices that you've made, and so the inequalities are not unjust. Mm. Now, that's a very powerful, really powerful argument.
An expression of freedom, actually, of choice.
But I think it's true. Marx was of this view, and I agree with him, inequalities that are actually an expression of freely undertaken choices without coercion are perfectly just inequalities. And that's why Marx said in communism, you should not expect, nor should you advocate for equality, because when people are genuinely free and they have different preferences about how hard they want to work, how long they want to work, some people will have more money than others, and that's okay. And I agree, that's okay. The problem with neoclassical theory isn't that it says that freely undertaken choices and the inequalities that result from them are just. The problem is that they think the choices undertaken under capitalism are freely undertaken. But if they actually were, then of course the inequalities that result would be fair as long as they don't result in new forms of social domination and exploitation.
Can I try and ask before my voice goes completely down? So, Vivek said as a third point where you said about the field in which a worker and employer meet is always field where two inequalities meet, and this field is actually infrastructure for this relationship.
For the bargaining debate.
Yes, this bargaining is always done in this infrastructure that imposes this inequality between them. But this actually looks something like a loose end a little bit. So it's not totally explained how this inequality, initial inequality, this initial infrastructure for inequality comes to being, right? And okay, we can talk about it, how this happens in United States. So every day you have this inequality, so you sort of inherit this infrastructure, and it's a sort of is existing for 200 or 300 years. But there is this experience that is contradicting this, and this is the experience of Eastern Europe, where the reconstruction of capitalism is actually being reproduced through ideological means, or whatever you want to call it, because it was reproduced as the narrative of socialism destroying some kind of real order, some sort of, I don't know, natural order of society. And then we need to just reconstruct capitalism, which is going to reconstruct both this also infrastructure of inequality. So in Eastern Europe, as if that there is no this initial infrastructure of inequality. So I don't know if I was clear.
Yeah, I think I understand what you're saying. What you're saying is that this infrastructure of inequality, or rather the pre-existing structural inequality between capitalists and workers, in a very important way frames their bargaining, and workers experience that frame as one that is oppressive and undesirable, and that's one reason that they resist. Whereas in Eastern Europe, they saw it as an emancipation. Yeah, and but understand why. It's because in the work relations in Eastern Europe, not only was there some degree of inequality between managers and workers, just like between capitalists and workers, but workers also lacked the formal freedoms that workers in capitalism have. Because you were assigned to a workplace, or you had limited autonomy of where you could work. There was limited autonomy in what kind of occupations you could join. And so what you had was much of the domination that capitalism has with it, although depending on the country you're in, that domination might have been blunted somewhat because of certain limits that managers had placed upon them. But nevertheless, there was a domination. Managers were managers, after all. But on top of that, you also lacked a lot of the freedoms, formal freedoms, that workers in capitalism in the West have. So initially, when you move to a market economy, there is a degree to which workers experience that move as the flourishing of freedoms which they didn't have before. And that's an ideologically powerful mechanism to get them to submit. But of course, once they do submit, I mean, maybe people don't remember, in Russia between 1991 and 1995, there's a wave of labor militancy and strikes because they experienced this freedom, but they also experienced the uncontrolled despotism that managers now, capitalists, owners now have over them. That wave of strikes was workers saying, we love the freedoms, but not the new despotism. Why did it disappear? Because they lost, they couldn't get anywhere with it. And in the end, all they had left was the choice, either you work or you don't. And so, of course, like every worker, they say, okay, we'll work. What choice do we have? So I think there's a material basis for some of the legitimacy that the bourgeois system was granted by workers after 1991. I don't think it follows that the quiescence of the workers since then is an expression of that same legitimacy. I think what's happened in the last 10 or 12 years, you guys would know more than me, is that workers have become inured. They've resigned themselves to this situation because this is the only reality now that they have open to them. And the challenge for those of you who live here is going to be how you entrench yourself in the workplace now, the way leftists have done before, and start working with labor on what resentments, what objections, what liabilities they face under the new system, against which right now most of them feel objecting to it, fighting against it, is a pipe dream, because it is a pipe dream right now.
I have a comment and a question regarding this, let's call it class politics from the right, from the different contemporary phenomena, from Trump, Brexit, and different so-called populist right movements across the Western hemisphere. I think that it's interesting the way how, okay, they always talk about how they respond to the needs of the ordinary people, most okay, white ordinary people, but they are somehow trying to also they also include this anti-establishment, anti-elitist rhetorics. And also is it interesting to me that the code word for this oppression is in most of the time it's political correctness. And in the sense that political is a code word for the coalition that has been so-called recognized from the right, coalition between the elites, however loosely that these elites are defined, and minorities. That is not minorities as such, of course, minorities, but I think that's the effect of the what you're talking about, the answer to the just question about middle-class identity politics, about professionalization of, let's say, social care for minorities and complete isolation of these kind of social impressions from the labor movement. And I think that there, let's call it their class theory is completely wrong, but you can see why the social source of its plausibility for many working class people of white working class people is really in a sense. So it seems to me that this kind of new right is politics, and I think it's Croatia also is, but it's more complicated because of the socialist legacy. And I might talk tomorrow. I'll try to
argue that Croatian radical right-wingers are the only ones in social, in political, only political force that are trying to articulate class politics, however idiotic it is, but is concrete. And I think that's the, in terms of destruction of the radical left and the, what you're talking about, and the complete lack of any kind of social mobilization, that this kind of the class theories are popping up from the for the right, from the right, because it somehow it reflects the social possibility of these theories is for the ordinary working people of correct color, and not only for them are plausible, but I think there's also the moment when we should include some kind of perspective, historical perspective, that is with of course also in Western Europe, but also in former Yugoslavia. We should not forget that there was up for class mobility for the working class, for the middle classes in 50s, 60s, 70s, and after, let's call it just conditional neoliberal turn, those who managed to survive without being declassed or going back to the position of their, I don't know, their parents or something like that, are now being the and there are also the some kind of social carriers of this anti-fascist values and this kind of, you know, progressive values, but they are as seen as not being declassed to this period of the last 30, 40 years. They are seen as the class enemies of the so-called ordinary people. So I think in some kind of class analysis and the role how ideology played in it and the class politics from the right, we have to include this historical class upward mobility in the 50s, 60s and the 70s, and use it as also as an analytical resource to understand contemporary new right mobility.
I think the crux of what you're saying is that what's happened, why people like Trump and the Brexit vote has been successful, is because they are articulating a certain vision or a view for the white working class, which appeals to them. And the left has not been able to respond to it. And I think that's absolutely true. And you also mentioned that there's somehow it's seen as a reaction to political correctness, which I think is also true. And the question we have to ask is why that message resonates with the white working class. The response on much of the left has been to kind of accentuate the demonization of the white working class, which is to say, to explain both the Brexit vote and the Trump phenomenon as a index or a sign of how deep racism has become within the white working class. And I think that's just fundamentally flawed, that view. And again, it reflects the social distance that's grown between people who call themselves the left and their what's supposed to be their natural constituency, which is the working class. It is of course true that there's lots of racism in the working class, but there always was. Unless you think it's genetically encoded in workers, you have to ask, well, where is it coming from? It's not coming from their whiteness, obviously. It's a response to a certain social situation. And the social situation, I think, is this, that as you say, for at least in the United States, there has never been a time when you've gone so long that it's right now we're going on 40 years where real wages have flatlined. Real wages today are about exactly what they were in 1973. So the only way the working class has been able to maintain its standard of living is by working longer hours and by bringing in more people from the family into the workplace. They've experienced the last 40 years as a struggle to just hang on. They've lost jobs. They've gone from union to non-union jobs, benefits to no benefits, protected jobs to precarious jobs, temporary jobs. Every single aspect of it has been seen as downward social mobility. The party and the organization that once represented them and fought for them no longer does. Their unions don't fight for them. They don't defend them. The Democratic Party doesn't defend them. Nobody does. At the same time, there have been massive and, of course, good gains along lines of civil rights and rights for minorities and for women. And employment opportunities have been opened up for them through things like affirmative action. Now, when jobs are plentiful, and there's lots of them, things like affirmative action will not elicit opposition and hostility from the working class. But when jobs are shrinking, then of course you get a scramble for what few openings there are. And every opening that a white worker doesn't get, they experience as some kind of discrimination against them. Now, that's not true, but they experience it that way. Furthermore, the left on campuses, which is now dominated by students and professors, tells them that because of their whiteness, they have nothing to complain about. Their lives are great. The real problem in the world is discrimination. Discrimination along lines of gender, along lines of race, and then, of course, all the prejudices that come along sexuality. So you have now the established order basically saying to the white working class that the real problem in societies is discrimination. The implicit counterfactual being, were it not for discrimination, everything that exists outside of discrimination in the market works pretty well. Markets work, we just need to end discrimination, right? So now, the basis for criticizing capitalism is gone. And the workers lose that anti-systemic consciousness that so many of you have been talking about. And what they say is, well, I'm not discriminated against, but I'm getting screwed left and right. Is anybody worried about me? The Democratic Party isn't. In England, the Labour Party isn't. It's telling them, we have to free up markets. In that situation, when the established left comes to white workers and says, you're racist, you're misogynist, you're homophobic, and what's more, you discriminate against the blacks, and you got to give up your privilege. What was Occupy saying to the people who came to the meetings? The white people in Occupy, leave your privilege at the door. Unless you've been in a graduate seminar for 4 years or something, you don't have health care, you don't have a job, you're holding, you can't pay your mortgage, and you're told to leave your privilege at the door? This is a left that is contemptuous of ordinary workers. Now when Trump comes and says, hey, I feel your pain, you've lost your job, and every time you open your mouth, somebody calls you a racist, well, that's bullshit. It's time we do away with political correctness. Of course they're going to listen. So it's a symptom of the fact, again, that what's called the left has no interest in class politics. What's called the left is fundamentally a middle class phenomenon whose real passion is discrimination, and whose implicit message is, if you're not being discriminated against, you've got nothing to complain about. And that's why the right is winning. And until the left finds a way of seeing that being white is okay, that poverty is real, and that addressing the fears and the anxieties of poor white people is part of the job of being the left, they're gonna keep going to the right. And you can close yourself up in the university, in the cafe, in the seminar room, and congratulate each other on how great you are. But that university is gonna be privatized pretty soon because of you.
We have Nina and then Tomislav.
Maybe it's also related to the last thing what you said, we are often, when organizing, we are often schizophrenic and we have patronistic approach to workers or the subject that we want to organize. So I wanted to ask you, since the majority of what you said will probably be a part of your book, I was just thinking, did you...
Well, not this part about how useless the left is. I have to have some friends in the world.
But the
underlying basis of it, yes.
What I would, for instance, like to see, I would actually like to hear what you think about when you will be writing about potentials of resistance and about organizational from organizational aspect, do you see what role politics of building trust plays for you, and do you consider that it should be given a more space, because often we're just taking it for granted, and I think that it doesn't come as natural as it should be, but it's a also a matter of organization or organizational aspect.
I think trust is the essence of left-wing politics. Without trust, nobody makes sacrifices. And what left-wing politics essentially is about is inducing people to make sacrifices, workers. Because taking up resistance if you're a worker basically means giving up time, giving up resources, and taking enormous risks, not just for yourself, but for other people. And unless you feel that the person with whom you're struggling is going to reciprocate, and your sacrifices will be met by their sacrifices, you don't want to be the sucker who goes and gives up everything for people who are just standing around and doing nothing. People aren't altruists. What people are is willing to reciprocate if they feel that the same willingness is going to be coming from the other side. So I think it's absolutely essential. What's happened in much of the campus left and the middle class left is that the not just the existence, but even the desire for trust has been evacuated. And it's because of the kind of middle class identity politics that's being exercised. Everybody who walks into a room, the default attitude on the part of the traditional left when you had a meeting was, everybody who's come to this meeting will be given the benefit of the doubt. They came here because they must want the same goals that we do. And they want to be decent, and they want to be comrades. They may be men, they may be heterosexual, they may be white, but they are coming here in order to treat us as equals if we're black, or if we're women, or if we're gay. What's happened today, and why this kind of contemporary left does not get off the campus, is that everybody has to pass a litmus test when they enter a room. Everybody is guilty until proven innocent. On the American left, you have genuinely idiotic things like, if you're white, every white person is racist to some degree. Imagine. So you come to an anti-racist rally, and as a white person, you're told, by virtue of being white, you're a racist. Why the hell would you try to be anti-racist then? You are, by definition, not ever going to be non-racist. You're telling them, right now, you will never be a comrade. That's just idiocy. And it shows this is a left that has no interest in succeeding in anything. It's simply interested in proving its moral superiority to everyone else. That's why I say, until the left gets off the campus, it is going to be a sideshow, a freak show, something that people go to perform and to report to others, but not to actually build anything. The essence of building is to be willing to trust the other person because they have come to the same organization as you. Now, they may fail, they may turn out to be racist, they may turn out to be sexist, but give them the chance to fail. Don't tell them that they have already failed by virtue of things they cannot control. That's where we are now. And that's why people respond the way they do to this political correctness business. It is a pox on the left.
Tomislav?
I agree about white working class in America, all that you said. My question is, how does the concept of workers' aristocracy fit in? And does it make any sense? And second question, what do you think about, you talk about guilt and all the stuff, what do you think about Walter Benjamin's idea about capitalism as a religious cult driven by guilt? How does this fit anywhere in this, in your...
Okay, I'm not a big fan of Benjamin, I'll just say at the outset, so if you want to believe that capitalism is driven by guilt, fine. Everything I've said so far suggests that that's not true. Benjamin's a strange guy. I don't understand a lot of what he writes, so that's a burden on you. You'll have to read him and try to make sense of him. Take up the issue of labor aristocracy. Let's separate out two issues. One is, can workers in particular situations be conservative, try to hang on to their privileges, try to hang on to whatever they've got, repel other workers? The answer is yes. That's different from asking whether there is a structurally generated layer of the working class because of, say, the structure of capitalism, what Lenin called monopoly capitalism, or because of the fruits of imperialism, etc., which makes it in the interest of those workers to align with management, and which induces them to be, as a layer, hostile to the interests and the drives of the rest of the working class? And the answer to that is no. Lenin was fundamentally wrong, both in the idea that more privileged workers are going to be conservative in his own country and in Europe in his time. The workers that were the most radical were the most privileged ones. And he should have known better. In the Vyborg district of Petrograd, in Moscow, it was the skilled machinists who led the revolution, not the contract workers, not the temporary workers. Same was true in France, same was true in England. The second component of that theory, which is the mechanism that is supposed to induce workers to be more conservative, which was the fruits of imperialism, was also wrong. What kind of capitalist makes extra profits? They go out into the supposedly the colonial world to generate extra profits, and then they take them and hand them over to their workers? Why do you need socialism if that's how the capitalists are? Never happened. The workers who had higher wages in England had higher wages because they had higher productivity. And the higher productivity generated more of a margin for workers to be able to get gains for themselves. They get their gains through their trade unionism, and then you turn around and tell them your success in getting higher wages is to be condemned because now you've become the labor aristocracy. Doesn't make any sense. Historically, it is true that there are times when workers who are better off are more conservative, but that's usually because they're fighting a defensive battle in the middle of an onslaught by management to take their gains away from them. That's what's been happening in the US. But that's different from saying that once a worker gets higher wages, he's going to become conservative. That's never been true. And it's also different from saying that those workers who, or those firms which are engaged in multinational production chains, et cetera, are going to buy off their workers and make them more conservative. That's never happened. And so I think the whole theory of the labor aristocracy is deeply flawed.
We have 10 more minutes. If anybody wants to give some additional comments, this includes also people who have spoken before. There is no policy of of once only. So Toni.
Yeah. Well, of course. I'd like to ask you, the academy in the US, I mean, I've had some experience of it in England, and it wasn't very, well, it was depressing at most times, but just it varies the degree of depression it induced. What kind of, can you discuss those things there? With whom? At what scale? Yes, you need to have some friends left, fine, you can come over more and more. Really, Marty, once they kick you out. And also, how did you get to tenure with this kind of,
camera's on. You expect me to talk about all this with the camera on, right?
Okay. We can talk over dinner.
I'll say this. The situation in American academia is not nearly as bad. It's not the McCarthy era. You know, I'm a Marxist, I'm not hounded out of the university simply because I happen to be a socialist or a Marxist. The system is actually quite open. The way it works is, being a Marxist doesn't mean you'll get fired. It simply means that you won't get all the goodies that your mainstream colleagues get. Surprisingly, that's enough to make people not be Marxists.
And this is the answer for the camera.
No, I really mean it. It's a very wide open, it's a gigantic system. It's not like here, it's not like Europe. Europe it functions more like a guild. Professors have a lot of power over who gets employed. Universities, it's easier to blacklist people. In the US, that's hard to do. So you may not, if you're a Marxist, you may not get a job at the top universities, but you will get a job at a good university. You may not become an endowed chair, but you'll get tenure. You just have to be willing to pay a little bit of the cost. And what I found, the secret to the American academic system, why there's so few Marxists, isn't because it's impossible to survive if you're a Marxist. It's that as a middle class person, you have to be willing to be happy with 90% of what you deserve. And that's not enough for most people.
We can end it on that note, or if someone wants to defend the honor of the academic, academic non-Marxists, nobody. Okay. So in that case, we'll end it here. Thank you, Vivek. Thank you, Toni. Thanks, all of you. So I hope it was as good for you as it was for me, but things will continue tomorrow. So to remind you, tomorrow at 11, we'll continue with a lecture by our own Marko Kostrić, a member of the Center for Labor Studies. The lecture is called, What is More Important in Life, the Economy or Ideology? This is a question I believe all of us want answered, so you should be here at 11 for Marko's lecture. So thanks again.